aspects to India now that you see. One is, and India, I mean, most of us are, you know, most of India now is engaged with Bollywood and with cricket. And there's that tiny little bit of India that's engaged with culture, our civilizational roots, and the art forms. I belong to that tiny little percentage of people who put arts and culture at the forefront of civic dialogue in whatever space I am. I'm here to tell you stories, I mean, because arts are all about stories, human stories. And not all successful people, as many speakers have told you, have lived with successes. So most often I'm asked whether dance chose me or I chose dance. Because the arts, especially in India, belong to a very niche, hereditary population called the Devadasis. The dancers and the musicians were hereditary dancers and hereditary musicians, and they belonged to the temples and later on to the courts. And as they sang along and as they danced along, their livelihood was taken care of by the patronage of the temples and the patronage of the courts later. When we became a democracy, the government took over the role of the patrons of art. And British India actually abolished these art forms, saying that they were impinging on the social morals of the population. Now that was a few people from high art talking about many, many in the artistic community as being compromised. And therefore, in you know, when you come to North India and you talk among the elite, people look at artists, dancers, and musicians, and generally kind of brush them away into a genre of nachne aur gaane wale. And that has happened for decades and decades. Nobody really engaged with artists on a serious basis. Nobody ever heard artists and thought about arts as being at the center of education of India. The reason that I, standing here, talk about the arts at every platform that I'm given is because I feel that the crisis in India today is because we did not give importance to our civilizational culture and artistic education and practice as the core of everything else that we did, because arts and culture is your identity, it's your core, it's not the periphery, it's not this dot, but it's where you stand at the center of the dot. I grew up in a family of professors, academicians, engineers, doctors, and management professionals, and within my own family, when I told them that I want to be a professional dancer, they said, no, no, why don't you have dance as a hobby? Why can't you take up civil service exams? Or, you know, work in, you know, in a bank or something, or do something else. So I said, no, I don't want to. I mean, I really, really want to be a professional dancer because I have something to say. And my family was aghast. Let me tell you this. My family, my immediate family was aghast. It was only my mother and later on my father who accepted that there could be a profession outside of the science element of being an engineer or a doctor or even the humanities, a management professional, or being in the services, an IAS officer or IFS officer. So they said, my mother very sweetly told me, okay, let's arrive at a compromise. Since all of us in our family are, you know, have a postgraduate degree, you can take up dance as a profession after you do a postgraduate degree, because if you don't succeed in the arts, you will at least have a backup plan and somebody can offer you a job. So I stepped into the world of dance not knowing, not understanding or not knowing whether I would actually make a livelihood of the arts or whether I would actually, you know, make a success of my life. And since I did not belong to the hereditary family, I had no backup. And since my family was full of professionals are usually academicians also, you know, all your teachers will tell you, are slightly proud. They say, we're not going to go and ask for opportunities for you. We cannot go and ask people to say, my daughter is a dancer, give her a chance to perform. That's below our, you know, I mean, that's not part of our mental makeup. Or it's not the way we behave. So my family kind of slowly withdrew, and they said that we're going to be supporting you from outside, but we're not going to be at the center of your dance space. So I had to carve out my own, you know, destiny by going through a forest which I barely understood, which I barely had any knowledge of, except for my teachers, my gurus, and my colleagues, who I kept seeing, you know, performing and analyzed. What did I do? Like the speakers before you have said, and like many others are telling you again and again, most of us feel that we are failures when we don't, you know, taste immediate success. But success can never be immediate, can never ever be immediate, because life is not a 100 meters dash. Life is a marathon. So you have to keep the energy up, you have to keep your spirits up, and you have to keep going, keep going, keep going. There's the story of the bird, you know, which is building its nest. It picks up a straw, one straw, another straw, another straw. There's a gale, and the nest just crumbles and falls down. But it doesn't give up. It goes back picking up the straws and building the nest, till the nest is ready, and then it, you know, the eggs hatch, the little eggs, little birds come. There's another gale, and everything falls down. The bird doesn't give up. The bird starts again building its own nest. So that is what life is. And that is what everybody has to understand what life is. And that is what the arts teach you. Because unlike the general impression that arts are just Nach Gana or whatever they are, let me tell you that you saw this wonderful artist from your own school performing when I just walked in. What does it do to you? It helps you reflect. It helps you think. It helps you ideate. It helps you create something out of nothing in the medium of your choice. It helps you analyze your own creation, which basically means reflect on your own creation. Self-criticize. Self-criticize and say, no, this is not good enough for me. I want something better than this. Helps you better yourself. Each time you come up on, you know, with something new, each time you practice, each time you put your heart, mind, and soul into it, something else flowers, something else comes out of it, which is better than the previous. It may be, you know, I think it's better, people say it's different, but different is also better because it's a movement in some direction. And any movement is good. Any movement in any direction is good. Stagnation is what is, you know, it's harmful for the individual, for the society, for the community, and for the nation as a whole. Stagnation is harmful. Movement is good, because movement means that people are putting their minds, their energies into doing something. So the arts also helps you think laterally, come up with lateral solutions. You may just think, oh, I didn't get good marks in my math, science, I'm finished. You're not finished, because you can attempt again. You can better yourself again. Some job you didn't get, some exam you didn't pass, you know, something you didn't do well enough, you didn't get the first prize. For example, in that musical chairs, you didn't win that chair. It's okay. It's perfectly okay, because that is not the only chair. Create your own chair. Manufacture your own chair and sit on your own chair. It doesn't matter, and say, okay, so you didn't give me the chair that I aspired for, I will create my own chair. And that's exactly what I did. Because when I started dancing, I realized that there was this dance mafia, as I call them. They were this little clique of opinion makers, connoisseurs, writers, bureaucracy, and politicians whose patronage you had to seek. And when you say seek, it means it's, you know, it's like demeaning seek. It's like begging and saying, please give me an opportunity. I decided that since I came from a different background, I couldn't do it because it was not, you know, I had to respect myself, and it kind of dented my self-respect. And I said, no, I can't do it. So what should I do? So I used to go to them, and then they would say, okay, in this festival, if you have to do, you've got to do X, Y, Z things. In that festival, you've got to meet X, Y, Z people, and things like that. I said, no, I'll create my own festivals. So in 1990, when I was barely, like, you know, mid-20s, I started Prasiddha Foundation. Prasiddha Foundation was a trust, and at that time I was in Bangalore, and Bangalore did not have any nationally important musicians or dancers, especially dancers. So I said, why not? And I did a SWOT analysis. You know what that is, right? Strength, weakness, analysis, test. And I said, I picked up 5-6 dancers, my generation and seniors, and I said, what is it that they have that I don't have? So I started writing it down. Every day, diligently, I would write down, so-and-so, plus, 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 minus, 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 so-and-so, plus, 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 minus. And I made this analysis a table. I put myself as part of that table, and I said, what are my pluses? What are my plus points? What are my strengths? And what are my weaknesses? And how do I somehow balance my strengths with my weaknesses to see that I reach the success that I want to see myself reaching? It's got nothing to do with anybody else. It's got nothing to do with, you know, your partner or your colleague or your friend or somebody else galloping ahead of you, because they gallop, yes. They may stop, because life is full of full stops. Life is not an open track where you keep galloping. No, life will put huge obstacles in everyone's path. There are no favorites. God has no such favorites that he favors some to, you know, gallop forever and some to fail forever. No, it all is based on your own individual conviction, your diligence, and your effort, and your commitment. So Prasiddha Foundation festivals in Bangalore became very famous, and I would invite artists from all over India to perform alongside Karnataka's artists, and many Karnataka's artists, almost about 200, 300 of them got national exposure, including me. And I was really thrilled because I had reached that stage without compromise. And my parents were very happy because they also thought that I had reached the stage without compromise. In 2000, I came to Delhi, and I started seeing all the premier cultural institutions over here. And by then, I used to go and perform in, you know, international festivals all over the world, Edinburgh, Tokyo, China, Belgium, America. And I said, why doesn't India have its own international arts festival? Because I realized that Indians don't come together on a single platform because they're competitive. I mean, it's like Sangeet Nat Academy was competing with Lalit Kala Academy, which was competing with Sahitya Academy, which was competing with Indira Gandhi National Center for Arts, because the incumbents thought that they all could not come together under one umbrella and do something for the nation, because they never put the nation or the image of India before themselves and their own little positions of power. I went to each one of them and I said, power is not what it is. Power is what it does. Today, you're in a position of power to be able to influence something. Do it if it's a positive influence. Because just sitting in a chair, you'll be sitting in that chair and 3 years later, you're out of the chair. What do you have to speak for yourself? What do you have to give to this community of artists, the connoisseurs, the dilettantes, people who do not even have exposure to the arts? It's your duty. It's your duty and your, you know, I mean, sacred duty, in fact, to expose the population to the arts, to the variety and diversity of the arts, so that they can choose what they want to do. Because without exposure, there's no choice. Without exposure, there's no judgment or evaluation. The first step is exposure. And so that is what I wanted them to do. In 2007, they all accepted, and under the organization that I started, of which I was the chairperson, it was called Forum for Art Beyond Borders, because I really believe that the arts dissolve borders between nations, and that the idiom of one world comes alive when all the artists perform, because arts are the best ambassadors of their culture, and they expose you to variety and diversity around you and make you feel like a little speck, you know, who is on this huge, beautiful journey of life, and it also makes you feel very, very happy and grateful to the universe to be part of that beautiful world. Because the arts have this knack of moving negativity towards positivity. It not only gives a positive impression of our city, of our country, of us as a people, because, you know, I was telling people that Delhi has to be known all over the world as the, you know, as a world-class city. And what is a world-class city? A world-class city is one that gives equal opportunities to everyone to flower and to be the best versions of themselves. A world-class city is a city of ideas. It's a city of arts. It's a city of academics where people can engage, deliberate, dissent, debate, and decide what is best for the nation. Just look at us today. Just look at us today, what is happening around us in our universities. And when I see that, I feel so sorry that these children, these universities, have not exposed them to the idea of acceptance of the other, of accepting another's point of view, of accepting another culture, accepting somebody else's perspective. It does not matter who you are, as long as you're confident in who you are, you can also have the confidence to listen to somebody else. Debate, dissent, accept, maybe question, which is fine, but not take up lattes and, you know, take up sticks and stones and start using your hands and your, you know, violence to engage, because arts tell you that violence is unacceptable. The arts give you a certain temerity, a subtlety, a nuanced life. And you have to understand that nuance is what defines life. Acceptance is what defines life, not belligerence, not aggression, not violence. You don't have to, you know, rush hard to be at the center stage. You will be center stage because you are who you are. You are a creation of this beautiful world, and you have reached your own potential, and you have the ability within yourself, like the speaker before me said, within yourself to be the best version of who you want to be. And that is what is important. So please, children, please understand that exams are not the be-all and end-all of life. They're not. And life is not a 100 meters dash. You may get the first rank. You may get 99.9999% and get into some premier college in Delhi. But then what you do with it is what is important. You may become, you know, one of the most important bureaucrats of our country, or you may head an educational institution, or you may even become the prime minister of our country. But what do you do with that power? What do you do with that position? That is what is important. And if you can put your country before you and use your talent to do whatever you can to the best of your ability for a larger good, for a larger population, and for the betterment of your people and others and for the country, then whatever you're doing in your life is the best, and your life remains fulfilled.